Hello, Internet. This is Sam Messman from We Make Movies here, and I am here to show you the new Final Cut 10 Red workflow. Apple's done some pretty awesome things with this, and it's made our lives as editors a whole lot easier. So let's go ahead and get started. The first thing I want you to do is right-click on the drive you want to work with and make a new event. And I'm calling mine Bed-Stuy Offline, which is the name of the short film. This is Bed-Stuy. And then I want you to make two new keyword collections. Make one called R3D and make another one called Sound. And basically what we're going to do now is import our footage. And I want you to go into your import preferences and uncheck a couple boxes. I want you to make sure copy files to Final Cut Events folder and import folders as keyword collections are unchecked, and also make sure your transcoding options are unchecked as well. Now, let's go into the Finder and import our red footage. I had 3 days of red shooting for this short film, and I'm gonna go into each day's worth of footage, and I'm gonna grab the individual roles or days, and I'm gonna drag them into my R3D keyword collection. You'll see that screen come up. Those are the metadata folders. You don't need to worry about that. Your footage is still going to come in. So just go ahead and bring each day and each role's worth of shooting, those folders, and drop them right onto your R3D keyword collection. It's going to assign an R3D keyword that you'll be able to reference back to later, and it's all going to get imported. Don't worry about those boxes that come up. And when you're done with that, I want you to go ahead and import all of your sound as well if you have secondary sound to import. And then you're going to do the same thing and drag that to your sound keyword collection. And once you've got all of your footage imported into Final Cut 10, go ahead and play back a couple clips. As you can see, I'm getting real-time playback of R3D files within Final Cut 10. And not only that, but I only have this connected to a simple little eSATA G-RAID. If I had a Thunderbolt attached, I would get multiple streams of real-time R3D playback. This is awesome. A couple notes on system requirements for Final Cut 10. My recommendation is at the minimum 12 to 16 gigs of RAM. You want a nice graphics card. Ideally, you're using a Thunderbolt attached drive or some sort of RAID solution. And one other thing I'd really recommend doing is getting a solid state boot disk for your machine, as it's pretty much the biggest performance upgrade you can make to your computer. I'm working off of the new MacBook Pro and it works fantastic, but if you have a Mac Pro or a relatively recent Intel Mac or iMac, you should be fine. Anyway, let's start grading our raw settings. Go in, select a clip, open the inspector, go into the info tab and click modify red raw settings. I've got that open. And as you can see, a HUD opens up and you can start affecting some of the red raw controls to your liking. Feel free to open up the video scopes, which is command 7. And then you can grade your raw right within Final Cut 10. Most of the important sliders that are in Red Cine X have been moved over to Final Cut 10. There's a way to use Red Cine X to grade your RAW as well. That's in another tutorial. Look at the bottom in the description for that if you want to see how to do that. But you have plenty of latitude within Final Cut 10 to get done what you need. You can also grade multiple red clips at one time. The way you do this, for example, go in and select all of your red clips. Then go make sure the info tab and the inspector is open. Click modify red raw settings. Generally what I use this for is to change the color space and the gamma space. Currently the latest from red is Redcolor 3, Redgamma 3. You set that, you click apply at the bottom, close out the HUD, and or leave it open if you want. And then you jump back into the event browser and you will notice that all of your red clips have now had those settings applied. Now I'll be covering your raw settings a little bit more in depth in part 2 once we've locked our edit and media managed our project. But a quick note is that at this point in the process, what I tend to do when I'm preparing an edit with red stuff is I just focus on the color space and the gamma space. I want to get to work as quickly as possible, and I don't want to necessarily affect the raw settings of all of my clips until I know which ones I'm actually using in the edit. So generally I'll make quick adjustments, fix simple mistakes, and then I'm going to move on and get going editing. And for those of you who are new to Red Workflow, the reason you're affecting your raw settings is because it gives you more control over your starting point before you reach color correction. And it allows you to non-destructively fix problems with white balance or exposure and not have to worry about degrading your image in any way. So the key principle of understanding raw workflow is you want to make the best possible starting point before you hit color correction with your raw images so that you can really fine-tune your image once you finish either in Final Cut 10 or another program like DaVinci Resolve. Now here's something I like to do as I'm setting up and prepping my red footage. Right click on one of the columns in the event browser and add the frame size column. It's gonna appear at the end there. Drag it over so that it's in the front and then arrange, click the disclosure triangle at the top or click on the column and sort your clips according to the frame size. As people who work with red know, it records at multiple resolutions and speed. I like to keyword according to these resolution so that I can quickly find and manipulate those clips when I need to, and this will also be searchable in the timeline index later on in your edit and will come in really handy. So basically go through, look at the frame sizes anytime you need to see a new frame size, select all those clips with that frame size and apply a keyword. This is great for keeping track of aspect ratios and the various different speeds that your red footage was shot at. All right, so I finished keywording, and what I'm going to show you now are some issues that you may run into with your R3D footage that you should be aware of before you start syncing it. I've laid out the exact same clip in three different ways here. One is just as the R3D appears normally, another is as a synchronized clip, and another is as a multicam clip. And I'm going to show you the difference in the spatial conform settings of these three clips. And if you're wondering what spatial conform settings are, well, basically it allows you to scale in on your clip either based on its native shooting aspect ratio, the project's aspect ratio, or on a native pixel-to-pixel basis based on the resolution of the original clip centered from the original image. Now go into the inspector and go into the spatial conform tab. Your default setting is fit. I set it to fill there and you'll notice that that worked fine. And now I'm gonna set it to none and you'll see the image scales in all the way. And let's set it back to fit and let's go and select our synchronized clip. Now when I do this to the synchronized clip here, you'll notice that there's no effect. Currently, this is a bug with the way Final Cut 10 handles synchronized clips, and you need to be aware of it. What my current recommendation is, instead of syncing your clips as synchronized clips, you sync them as multicam clips, as these will allow you to use the spatial conform tab as you go between resolutions in your edit, when you're onlining, all of this stuff. Otherwise, if you use synchronized clips, you're going to have to break apart your synchronized clips once you begin onlining if you want to affect the spatial conform settings. This is my biggest request from Apple in terms of fixing their R3D workflow so that people can safely use synchronized clips and preserve their spatial conform and transform adjustments as they move through their workflow. So that covered what you need to know about syncing your clips. But what I'm going to show you now is a few things you can do as you prep your multicam footage to make some of that go a little bit smoother and a little bit faster. Now I want you to go into the inspector and scroll down, and on the bottom there you'll see a little pop-up and select extended view. This is going to give you access to more metadata columns that you can rename as you go through and sync your clips. So anyway, what you can see is I've selected all of my audio clips and I've renamed the camera angle to Z audio. And now I'm gonna rename my video angle, a video camera angle, to video. Now, the reason I put Z in front of the audio is because when Final Cut X makes the default video angles when you make your multicam clips, it assigns them alphabetically. So you want audio to be last, so that's why I put a Z in front of it. It's just a trick that I use because it guarantees that Final Cut will set the default angle to a video image so that I won't see a black screen when it makes my multicam clips. Anyway, go ahead through now and make all of your multicam clips if you have additional sound, and go and prep your project as you would normally. I highly recommend using the batch rename feature that I won't cover in too much detail here, but the good news is that I made a separate tutorial specifically for this feature. So if you're more interested, go to my tutorial page on the We Make Movies site and check it out. It's one of the coolest things in Final Cut 10. Let's go ahead and take a minute and examine, before we start transcoding our proxies, how Final Cut 10 is managing your red media. So go into your Final Cut events folder that contains your event and click over onto your event, and then you'll see a few folders within it. You'll see original media and transcoded media. We haven't transcoded anything yet, but we're about to. But what I want you to do now is go over and click on the original media folder. Now, as you can see, Final Cut has added reference files for all of your sound files, but it's also added reference folders for all of your red media. And within each of those folders is a reference to the original R3D file that it's accessing, as well as an RMD file, which is the red metadata file. And what that file does is it stores all of your raw adjustments to the color or brightness or exposure that you make, for example, in Red Cine X. Now, something to be aware of is that if those files are not generated beforehand, you will not be able to grade and update your raw in Red Cine X. I cover that in the Red Cine X to Final Cut 10 tutorial that I made, but it's something to be aware of. You want to generate RMDs before you import your footage into Final Cut. Also, it's best practice to not let Final Cut import your red files into the original media. You want to use clip references. The reason for this is that it's a huge disk space saver, and unless you need them on your Thunderbolt drive, it's generally going to save you just a ton of space. If you work with clip references originally and then media manage everything once you're done with your offline and just work with the clips you've used, I'll show you how to do that in a little bit. Now let's step back into Final Cut, and I'm going to show you how and why you want to use proxy footage for your offline edit. So why would you ever want to use transcoding to proxy? Well, basically, if your system is a little bit underpowered, or you're cutting something like a feature where you need to maximize performance, or you're mixing and matching formats between other cameras, there are numerous reasons that are mostly performance-based where transcoding to proxy, I think, will really help you when you go back to your original R3D files. Now, why would you want to transcode to proxy in Final Cut 10 versus, say, Red Cine X Pro or Resolve and just go out to regular 1080 ProRes files? Well, the reason for that is because Final Cut 10 proxies are just half-size representations of your original R3D media. And what those proxies allow you to do is any changes you make to a proxy when you go back to your original media in Final Cut 10, those changes are gonna get reflected. So for example, if you make changes to your scale or any of that stuff, it's going to be referencing your original R3D, whereas if you transcode in Red Cine X or Resolve, those changes are baked in and you're gonna have to redo them all over again. With Final Cut 10 proxies, that's not the case. Any changes you make to the proxies are gonna get made to the R3D whenever you decide to go back to it. This is a huge advantage and something that's unique to Final Cut 10. Anyway, let's go ahead and make some proxies. Select a range of clips. This is just a demonstration. You can select all of them if you'd like. And then you're gonna right click and select transcode media. And this is gonna bring up a window with two options, which is either to create optimized media, which you'll make 444 representations of your footage, or what we want to do is create proxy media, and that's going to make the half size renders that I was talking about earlier. So go ahead and click OK. I'm going to click cancel because I've already made some of a real footage that I'll be using later in the lesson. And as far as when you should do this, I would recommend doing it towards the end of the day when you're done editing and getting all of your footage organized so that you can let this go overnight and then be able to work with them the following day. And once you are done transcoding, I want you to go back into your preferences and go under the playback menu and then go ahead and select use proxy media. Now, when you do that, one thing you should be aware of is that it's going to take offline any clips you haven't converted to proxy. So what you're going to want to do is make sure all of the footage that you plan on working with, you transcode. Because anything that's not proxy, as you can see, is going to go offline. And this is something else that I'm hoping Apple's going to fix in a future release of the software, and that you'll eventually be able to use Optimize and Proxy Media together. But for the time being, in order to make this work, every single clip you plan on using in your edit needs to be transcoded to proxy, or you're not going to be able to use it when you're in proxy mode. Anyway, that's going to do it for part one of this tutorial. In part two, I'm going to show you how to work with your red footage in your timeline, and then also online your footage so that you can finish at multiple different resolutions, anywhere from 1080 to 4K, and get ready to either finish within Final Cut 10 or in other programs like DaVinci Resolve. And also, all the steps from this tutorial have been posted in the description below. And if you have any questions or things you notice that you want to add to this workflow, post them in the comment section and I'll try and get back to you. At the end of the day, the goal here is to make all of this stuff as seamless and easy as possible. And I'd love your feedback on how to make it all better. And if you watch this and it all went totally over your head, or you just don't feel like doing it, well, this is what I do for a living, so feel free to hire me either to consult on your movie or to finish your film for you if that's what you need. So, if you want to get in touch, just drop me an email over at sam@wemakemovies.org. And lastly, if you're wondering what this whole We Make Movies thing is, check us out over at wemakemovies.org, or if you live in LA or Toronto, sign up for our newsletter and then come to one of our events. I'll see you guys next time.
And cut!